Test 1 2 1 2. Testing 1 2 3. 1 2 3. Testing 1 2 3.
Good afternoon and welcome to today's hearing regarding the Environmental Control Board debt. I am Councilmember Julissa Ferreras Copeland and I chair the Committee on Finance. We are joined today by the Committee on Governmental Operations chaired by my colleague Councilmember Kales. We've also been joined by Councilmembers Mario, Rosenthal, Cumbo, and Levine. Today we are holding an oversight hearing as well as considering five bills, one of which is in Finance Committee and four of which are in the Governmental Operations Committee. The oversight portion of the hearing will examine the Department of Finance's first annual report regarding outstanding ECB judgment debt, which was issued this month as a result of legislation passed by the Finance Committee this past January. Before we begin, I'd like to thank the staff of the Finance and Legislative Division for their work they did preparing for this hearing. Specifically, my Chief Counsel, Tanisha Edwards, Assistant Counsel, Rebecca Chasen, Finance Analyst, John Russell, and James Sabuti, Committee Counsel, Smita Deshmukh, and Policy Analyst, Lori Wen. The legislation in the Finance Committee that we are considering today is proposed intro 806A, sponsored by myself, which would authorize the Department of Finance to hold a temporary amnesty program to forgive certain ECB debt. The remaining four pieces of legislation we are considering are in the Governmental Operations Committee, and Councilmember Kalos will speak about those bills in his opening statement. For the benefit of the public, Mike, and my colleagues, I will provide a little background on ECB and the process by which notice of violations are adjudicated. ECB is an administrative tribunal that adjudicates hearings on notices of violations issued by the city's enforcement agencies for various qualities of life infractions, such as sanitation code or building code violations. ECB does not issue notice of violations itself, nor does it direct, control, or otherwise influence where, when, or to whom notices are issued. Once an agency writes a quality of life ticket, it is referred to ECB for adjudication. It is after a hearing, if after a hearing ECB finds that the respondent was in violation, then it will impose penalties. If the respondent does not pay the fine or appear before ECB, then they are in default and ECB will impose default penalties. Outstanding ECB judgments debt results when either the penalty or default penalty is not paid and ECB dockets the judgment in court and refers the case to the Department of Finance for collection. Earlier this year, in an effort to bring about more transparency in the ECB debt collection process, the Council passed Local Law 11. That requires an annual report from DOF to the Council detailing the amount of outstanding ECB judgments at DOF, the enforcement tools used by DOF, and the success of DOF's collection efforts. The first such report was issued this month, and it revealed that there is currently $1.58 billion in outstanding ECB judgment debt, up $91 million from June 2014. Of this amount, $386 million is interest, $709 million is penalties, and approximately 75% of the total debt owed is more than 2.5 years old. $200 million of the outstanding debt is in for judgments docketed in fiscal 2015, and DOF reports that it has collected $17.7 million or 8.8% of the fiscal 2015 debt. The Council appreciates the steps DOF has taken to pass this past year to be more effective at collecting ECB debt, including documenting the outstanding debt in its recent report. Beginning to use the sheriffs and the marshals to collect debt and sending out more than 150,000 enforcement letters. However, there's always a however, the data in the report demonstrates that there is still room for improvement. We look forward to hearing from DOF and on what recommendations it has for future enforcement initiatives that could help bring the collection rates up even higher. And one recommendation that DOF has made in the past is being considered by the Council today in the form of proposed intro 806A, which would create a temporary amnesty program under which respondents could resolve their outstanding ECB debt. Respondents who have default judgments would be able to resolve their debt by paying the base penalty and having the default penalties and accrued interest waived. Respondents who have judgments against them as a result of being found in violation after an ECB hearing would be able to resolve their debt by paying 75% of the imposed penalty and having the accrued interest waived. DOF administered a similar program in 2009 that did not have a very high participation rate. As a result, the proposed legislation includes a provision stating that eligible respondents who do not participate in the amnesty program will be offered a less generous settlement agreement should they try to resolve their debt with DOF after the program has ended. In addition to the requirements of the legislation, DOF has agreed to investigate additional administrative steps to incentivize respondents to participate in the amnesty program, including reporting delinquencies to credit rating agencies, including questions about outstanding ECB debt on both the vendor and principal Vendex questionnaire, cross-referencing entities with outstanding ECB debts with the vendors who already have or are applying to have contracts with the city for purposes of holding city contracts until the debt is paid, and asking the city's depository banks whether they have any outstanding ECB debt and encouraging them to pay. Before I turn the mic over to my co-chair, Councilmember Kalos, to speak to the details of the four bills pending in this committee, I'd like to briefly talk about Intro 807, which I have sponsored. When agencies issue notices of violation to generic owners of, quote unquote, a property or business, Intro 807 would require the agency and DOF to use best efforts to learn the respondent's true name, including a respondent's true name on the ticket, would provide stronger due process for respondents, as well as provide better information for DOF as it attempts to collect outstanding debt through telephone calls and letters for seizures or ousts. I would like to remind my colleagues that we are covering a lot of ground today, so I will encourage everyone to ask questions and engage with the administration. I will do my best to be brief with my questions, and I ask my colleagues to do the same. We will have multiple rounds of questions, so council members will have plenty of time to participate in today's hearing. And now we will hear from Council Member Co-Chair Kalos.
Good afternoon, and welcome to this joint hearing of the Committee on Finance and Governmental Operations. Councilmember Ben Kalos, Governmental Operations Chair, and you can tweet me or hit me up on social media at Ben Kalos. I'd like to thank our Finance Chair and my co-chair for this hearing, Councilmember Julissa Ferreras Copeland, for all of your hard work on this. We've been working together on this for very long time. I'd also like to thank, as have already been thanked, Tanisha Edwards, Rebecca Chasen, John Russell, and James Sabuti from the Finance Division. I'd also like to thank Governmental Committee Analyst Lori Wen and my Legislative Director Paul Westrick, who have been really doing really great work for the committee and carrying us to this point. And some amazing news, we are joined by a new member, and welcome to the team, Smita. We look forward to working with you as our committee counsel. The chair has already gone over, the outstanding ECB debt was an issue that these two committees have been focused on for a year and a half now. It resulted in Local Law 11 of 2015, carried by Councilmember Julissa Ferreras Copeland, which led to a recently released DOF report we'll be discussing today, and also to much of the legislation on today's agenda, all of which I support. A month after our joint hearing in May of last year, DOF produced another report on ECB debt, which explained the difficulties in collecting on the money owed to the city and made a number of recommendations for improving the summonses or notices of violations issued by 13 city agencies, as well as incentivizing those found in violation to actually pay the money they owe to the city. At issue here was $1.48 billion, now is $1.6 billion, in outstanding money owed to the city of New York. The city spends money to enforce building safety, maintain clean streets and sidewalks, and uphold the quality of life of New Yorkers. Since we spend resources issuing these fines, we must ensure we have the ability to collect on them and use that money for needed services. This $1.6 billion that could be spent on school lunches, senior centers, free CUNY, building affordable housing. Today's hearing focuses on both pre- and post-hearing aspects of these types of violations. Introductions 807, 811, 812 focus on improving the integrity of the summonses issued by the city agencies through, respectively, requiring efforts to find respondents' true name as opposed to citing a generic owner of, requiring agencies to review each summons for errors and the time to correct them, and requiring that the summons include the borough block and lot number and building identification number of the violation. Thousands of summonses are dismissed each year as defective. Ensuring that a summons issued by an inspector is legible, contains a specific and correct address, and contains the correct name of the respondent and section of law cuts down on the amount of time wasted issuing defective summonses, and furthermore makes the task of collection much easier. Intro 810 focuses on incentivizing payment after the hearing. What we've seen, particularly with violations issued by DOB, is repeat offenders racking up fines and refusing to pay them. Having the agencies notify individuals and business entities that non-payment will result in license and permits being suspended or revoked, or result in applications of license for licenses and permits being denied, is a powerful incentive for respondents to either pay the fines immediately or enter into a payment plan with DOF. After discussing these bills with both agencies slated to testify today, we've agreed to make several changes, particularly to Intro 810. The consensus seems to be that the agencies should be required rather than encouraged to suspend or revoke licenses and permits for any fine and judgment without a waiting period or monetary thresholds that are currently specified by the legislation. We are joined by Councilmember Robert Cornegy and had been joined by Councilmember Danique Miller and Councilmember Van Bramer. I'd like to now turn it over to Finance Chair Julissa Ferreras to swear in our witnesses.
Do you affirm that your testimony will be truthful to the best of your knowledge, information, and belief?
You may begin your.
Good afternoon, Chairwoman Ferreras Copeland and Chairman Kalos, and members of the Committees on Finance and on Government Operations. I am Jeffrey Shear, Deputy Commissioner for Treasury Payments and Operations for the Department of Finance, DOF. Thank you again for the opportunity to present our report on the collection of debt resulting from violations adjudicated by the Environmental Control Board, which is part of the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings, or OATH. These summonses are issued by many city agencies for safety and environmental violations, such as building code and sanitation infractions. The primary purpose of the violations is to change behavior so that we may all live in a safer, cleaner city. Collecting past due debt on these violations provides incentives for this behavior and has the additional benefit of generating revenue for essential city services. As you know, DOF testified on this topic last year. At that time, we indicated that while this debt is more challenging to collect than other types of city-issued debt, there was much more that we could do to better understand and collect it. We agreed with the council that DOF could do better in analyzing the debt, taking more enforcement action, and generating more revenue. This year, I am here to say that we have made good progress. We supported council-sponsored legislation to improve the quality and transparency of information on ECB-adjudicated debt. This legislation became Local Law 11, which requires us to submit a report to the council and the public each November that focuses on the overall inventory of debt as well as information pertaining to judgments DOF received in the previous fiscal year. We presented the first report on November 2nd and will review it today. We also supported the provisions of Local Law 11 that authorized Department of Sanitation issued judgments to be referred to city marshals. This law has contributed to a significant increase in referrals to both the city sheriff and city marshals. Referrals to enforcement agents went from single digits during the past several years to nearly 500 during fiscal year 2015. This and other initiatives have contributed to an improvement in debt collection in the 2015 fiscal year to a record $50.1 million, a 21% increase over the $41.5 million collected in fiscal year 2014. I will start my testimony today with a presentation relating to our Local Law 11 report. It begins with some background information, highlights the findings of the Local Law 11 report, includes some additional analysis, and concludes with next steps. After the presentation, I will turn to the legislation before the committees today, introduction numbers 806A, 807, and 810. Oath will address introduction numbers 811 and 812. So we've handed out the slideshow and we also are projecting it. Now is a good time for me to thank Daniela Kerme, who was chief analyst of the report, as well as Pamela Parker Cortijo sitting behind me to my right, who also played a key role. So we will start with context. So without going through the entire process here, this slide reinforces remarks made by Chairwoman Ferreras Copeland. We are at the end of a long process. First, summonses are issued by various city agencies. They may be paid prior to hearing or they may be adjudicated. If the summonses are not paid, not adjudicated, or if a respondent loses at adjudication, ultimately the summonses are entered into judgment and referred to the Department of Finance. In fiscal year 15, New York City received $96 million as a result of these judgments in the pre-judgment mode before they were referred to the Department of Finance. Most of the violations that can be docketed by ECB are resolved prior to DOF referral. As you can see, 53% of them are paid in full, 9% are dismissed through the hearings process, and the remainder that are not resolved are docketed and referred to the Department of Finance. This slide details the nearly $1.6 billion in outstanding judgment violations. The total is due to the 8-year lifespan of the judgments, as well as the fact that most of the judgments we receive pertain to violations for which a respondent did not appear for a hearing, and failure to appear at a hearing results in default penalties that can be fairly sizable. The average age of the inventory is 4.3 years. Or I should say the average age of a judgment in the inventory is 4.3 years, roughly the halfway point of the 8-year cycle. Here's a chart detailing collections over the last several years, showing that last year we collected $50.1 million, as indicated that was a record for us. And there is an upward trend over the last several years. The next part of the report is dedicated to Local Law 11. We've printed the website at which it's posted. One of the breakdowns required by the report is an inventory by agency. You can see here that while many agencies issue debt that's adjudicated by ECB, The two primary agencies are the Department of Buildings and the Department of Sanitation. They make up 79% of the total outstanding debt and 85% of the outstanding penalty amounts. The fiscal year 15 referrals to the Department of Finance from ECB. We received 218,000 judgment violations for a total of more than $200 million, including penalties. As you can see from this chart, more than half of the amount of the judgments we receive are due to the default penalties. We were asked about the length of time to transfer judgment debt to DOF. It is a little bit more than one day. I think this was brought up because in the past, there had been some delays in terms of docketing of the judgments and referral to DOF, but now ECB dockets the judgments on a regular cycle, and we receive them almost immediately. I'll take a little more time with this next slide. We were asked for collection rates. Collections increase over time as we have more time to try to collect, but the rate at which the revenue increases slows as the judgment debt ages. So after 15 months, the collection rate on the fiscal year 15 judgments was 8.8%. That is what we reported in the Local Law 11 report. However, if one follows the judgments over time, we can see that the rate grows as they age. So for judgments that go back to fiscal year 14 that we had 2 years to collect on, the collection rate is 11%. And we did an extrapolation based upon all of the collections we received during fiscal year 15, and we project that for the newly referred judgments, not to the whole inventory, but just to the $200 million that came in this year, that during their lifetime, we will collect 24%. Our fiscal year 15 collection efforts, as previously indicated, we and our collection agencies sent out a total of over 150,000 collection letters. Other fiscal year 15 initiatives include, as mentioned, the increased use of sheriff executions. An execution is a legal name for the referral to the sheriff's office. We had 430. The new execution program with the city marshals resulted in 52 executions. And we also initiated debt rotation amongst our collection agencies. So a collection agency that has had debt for a long time was asked to give it up and give it to a different collection agency that could work the debt freshly. And we found that in the 6 months after debt collection, that nearly $4.5 million more was produced than in the 6 months prior to the debt rotation. We were asked to provide information on expired judgments. The judgments last statutorily for 8 years. This chart breaks down the judgments that expired during fiscal year 15, $85 million. This last section starts with information that I believe is in the Local Law 11 report, but then also talks about other analyses that we are performing. So one of the pieces of information is the collection rate by issuing agency. So this is a collection rate on fiscal year 14 judgments. So this is 2 year collection rates. And you can see that the Department of Transportation and the Fire Department, their violations have the highest collection rates. As indicated, we have more work to do, and part of that is further exploring challenges to further increase in collections. So we did have $900 million worth of debt that's now been worked by two different collection agencies. The debt's very old. We have the Department of Finance, since the 2009 amnesty program, has had a policy of abating penalties upon request in drawing up settlements with respondents. As a result of that, 75% of the penalties are uncollectible. This means that $530 million of the inventory, based on the current policy, could not be collected. And lastly, we have $175 million of inventory that's attributed to limited liability companies. We did a special enforcement project during fiscal year 15 and had an extremely low collection rate on this debt, less than 1%. So we are very concerned about this. It is a growing part of the inventory, and we are trying to figure out how to tackle it. I spoke a little bit about debt rotation earlier. Here's some additional information. We made two assignments. First, we rotated $500 million worth of debt. More recently, we've done a second debt rotation of $400 million. We are now looking at the first group in particular that was rotated for the possibility of doing some write-offs to better reflect the inventory and what the city can expect to receive against it. This slide emphasizes an earlier point. In fiscal year 14, we abated $3 of penalties for every $1 of penalties collected. This again is attributable to our policy, the historic policy since 2009, of abating penalties upon request for settlement agreements. And we wanted to highlight some other issues that are under review, which we think will have an effect on collections, but which we need more time to explore further. Property changes of ownership since the issuance of violations to respondents. It's harder to find a debtor if, after they received a violation, they sold their home. They may be living in the city, they may have moved out of the city or out of state. Respondents that have gone out of business, moved out of the city, or passed away. We need to quantify how large that is in terms of the inventory. And some portion of the inventory represent violations issued against respondents who are not property owners, such as littering or pooper scooper violations. When a respondent owns a home, it's more likely that they will have assets to pay the violation. It's more difficult to collect when the violations are issued to a member of the public. Finally, we want to conclude on next steps. We do agree that it is time to have another amnesty program. This will help improve communication and outreach to the public at large. We want to incentivize participation. We are proposing that after amnesty, that settlements only abate 50% of penalties rather than 100% of penalties. And we are ramping up enforcement, both through enforcement agents and through other methods, such as stopping vendor checks. We also want to address the high penalty amounts. We have been working with Oath and the Department of Buildings on reducing default penalties, cutting them in half if the respondent fixes the underlying condition that led to the violation in the first place. write-offs I've spoken about. We want to accurately reflect the collectible portion of the inventory. Even though we want to write off judgments, the judgments will remain in effect for the full 8-year statute period. And we will start with the review of the debt that has been worked by the two collection agencies. And we are also restructuring our internal efforts to increase annual revenue, accelerate collections, so we are working the more recent debt and doing more debt analysis. So that concludes the presentation. So now I will return to the testimony on the bills that stand before the committee.
Successfully dwindled us down to 3 members. So let's do like an edited version of your statement now.
I will, okay. Intro 806A, I will skip the outline of the provisions and say, beyond what is mandated in the amnesty legislation, the Department of Finance will also administratively obtain employer identification number information for city vendors and match that against vendors' ECB judgments to stop vendor payments to respondents with judgment debt. We plan to put this in motion and believe we can complete it by the time the amnesty period ends. We believe the amnesty program, combined with those new enforcement efforts, will improve how quickly we obtain money owed to the city so that the funds can be used for essential programs and services. For 807, which is the owner of legislation, the department generally supports this legislation, although it largely impacts agencies which issue violations and they may have additional operational concerns. While the number of these violations is not insignificant, with 3,284 judgment violations totaling $8 million in our inventory issued to owner of properties, it is very small relative to the overall inventory of 1.4 million violations totaling nearly $1.6 billion. We do not support the provision requiring DOF to mail a copy of the default decision in these cases. This is already done by ECB, and we issue our own collection letters. For intro 810, which is the bill that has provisions pertaining to license and permit suspension, DOF supports the concept that agencies should suspend, revoke, and deny licenses and permits for certain reasons. However, for some agencies, particularly those that ensure safety conditions, suspending or revoking a permit or license could complicate the regulatory process, and it is important to ensure that their views are taken into account as we continue conversations about this legislation. One example where an agency has been successful in striking the right balance is the Department of Transportation. It has a successful permit suspension program. However, the bill as currently envisioned may potentially result in fewer actions against licenses and permits because of the high dollar and lengthy time triggers in Section 8. These need to be reworked with issuing agencies and DOF or left to DOF rulemaking. Another option is the council may wish to consider requiring licensing and permitting agencies to report to the council on the extent to which they are currently checking licensees, permittees, or applicants to determine if they have outstanding judgments. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. The department appreciates the attention the council has brought to this issue and our ongoing work to improve our collection efforts. I welcome any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. We've been joined by council members Rodriguez, Torres, and Johnson. Thank you for the report. It gave us a lot of information and we were, you know, we digested a lot, but it also has given us opportunities to ask questions, and that's why we're here today. I know that it was stated the past year DOF has made a significant effort to increase and strengthen its collection efforts, including documenting this outstanding debt in the report, sending out more than 150,000 enforcement letters and starting to use sheriffs and marshals. But even with those improvements, it seems that for fiscal 2015's collection rate was only 8.8%. You mentioned that in the coming years, it seems like we've known that if the debt is older than 2 years, it is more difficult to collect. Yet in one of your slides, you stated that as the new debt gets older, your rate goes up. So I'm confused.
Yes. And actually, one thing before I go into that, Commissioner Del Valle is here to testify on intro 811 and 812. So I wonder if we might have him.
Can join us also if this can help us through the process, Commissioner?
I think the plan is to reserve the questions that he can answer for him so that they can testify separately. DOF is the collections entity while ECB is a judicial body.
So please have someone document the questions that we're asking because we're gonna have to ask them again to you right after. So if someone can just.
Sorry about that, that's the plan.
Appendix slide? It's the last slide. Yes, do we have it in the? So to answer your question, if you turn to the last page of the deck that was handed out. So we tried to address that here. So what we are saying.
So I guess what I'm asking is you had another slide that showed the collection at 24% once we got.
Yes.
Right, but you passed it. I think you gotta go.
So.
Look for the page.
It's Appendix A.
Appendix A, yes.
Okay.
So what we are saying is if you add up all of these bars together, they add up to 24%.
In total for over the 8 years, not that at the eighth year you're gonna collect 24%.
That is correct.
Okay.
Sorry now, if that was not clear.
Thank you for clearing that. And then I just wanted to kind of go back to the 8.8%. If I'm looking at the 8.8% and I'm watching this, and I'm at home and I just got an ECB fine, and you are only collecting 8.8%, I'm gonna take my chances and not pay the debt. So what incentivizes people if it seems that you're having a hard time collecting the debt for the fine? So if you get a sanitation ticket, and you cross your fingers, you may never have to pay it.
Yes, well, I think that is why we are ramping up our enforcement efforts, because we did have more people this year where we were seizing bank accounts and where people were contacted directly by marshals and by the city sheriff.
Okay, so let's kind of follow through on that. Can you enumerate all the enforcement tools that you have available? In our report, as required by Local Law 11, you stated that the enforcement tools that DOF used in fiscal 2015 were the sheriffs and marshals and sending out Dunning letters. However, at last year's hearing, you testified that you also make calls and do bank restraints and you have also informed the council that you have frozen contracts. Were these enforcement tools used in fiscal 2015? And if they were, why weren't they included in the report?
So the bank restraints, those are done by the sheriff and by the marshals. We are not authorized to do those on our own. So they represent the subset of the executions that were referred to the city sheriff and to the marshals.
So can you walk me through what happens when debt is given to the sheriff? We've been joined by Council Member Greenfield. What is the process when debt is sent to the sheriffs and the marshals? Because I think last time we kind of talked about the collection agencies, but tell me what happens to the sheriffs and the marshals, and this is a tool that you're saying is authorized or used by sheriffs.
Yes. When we send a legal document to the sheriff or to the marshals that empowers them to use the means at their disposal to collect the debt, and they may impose additional fees as authorized by law on that debt, they use a variety of techniques. I think they may send their own letters to the debt judgment debtors, they may visit them, or they may, if they identify a bank account, they may levy upon that bank account.
Okay, and what kind of debt is sent over to the marshals? Like, is it a mixture of new debt and old debt? Is it only sanitation debt? Is it a particular debt? Like, how are you engaging with the sheriffs and the marshals?
It's a mixture. We're trying to focus more on the newer debt as we go through the inventory and catch up. It is typically debt where we are able to identify a potential asset, or it is debt that's over a certain dollar amount.
Okay. Well, I'm hoping that with this package of legislation, we're able to bring clarity to some of the issues that you have with collection. It is very disconcerting that we're only collecting 8.8% of this total debt that we have kind of looming. And do you see the process of how do you just write off the debt that you know you're not going to be able to collect? What does that process eventually look like?
Well, we're going to come up with criteria that we want to share, but that will articulate that certain efforts have been made and that we stand little chance of collecting, perhaps because someone is deceased, perhaps out of business, moved out of the city. But
do you currently have a process to say, we figured out that this person is deceased? Do you do that now with the debt that we currently have?
We currently mark our system, so when we discover a debtor is deceased or a business has ceased to function, there is an uncollectible code on our system, but we have not been writing the debt off, which is a formal process.
So you consider uncollectible incorrect information such as name and or address listed by issuing agency that renders a judgment unenforceable. Obviously a debtor is deceased and bankruptcy filing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you say you put this in an uncollectible code. Does that take it out of the total that we've been talking about? It does not. And how much of that debt is in that code?
I'll have to get back to you.
Okay, please do. I just want to very quickly have a couple of questions on the amnesty bill directly. But in 2009, DOF held an amnesty program similar to the one we would be authorizing in proposed intro 982A. 806A. Yeah, I was going to say, I'm giving it another number. 806A, through the 2009 program, DOF collected approximately $14.3 million in base fines and waived approximately $33.7 million in combined interest and default penalties. How many respondents participated in the 2009 program?
I don't have that figure with me.
Can you please get it to the committee?
Yes.
What, if anything, will DOF do differently from this year's program to increase its participation?
Yes, so we do support a provision that would reduce the amount of penalties we would abate after an amnesty program. We feel that with enough outreach and publicity and knowing that we are offering tougher deals and as well as ramping up our enforcement efforts, more use of the enforcement agents, sheriff and marshals, and doing the vendor checks that we've talked about, that will drive more people in to participate.
So I know that you mentioned kind of a marketing strategy. So what do you look like? What will that advertisement with DOF look like for this amnesty program?
I'm sorry, not following.
So obviously we have to inform people that there's an amnesty program.
Yes, we do.
So what are the strategies that you're going to be using to let New Yorkers know there's an amnesty program, it starts this date and it ends this date? We need you to participate.
We are working on that right now.
Okay. So I would urge you to continue to engage with this council. We have many ways of communicating with our constituencies, but also being able to use any of the interfaces, any of the multicultural newspapers and other very diverse ways that we can get the message out. So don't just use your traditional ways of communicating with New Yorkers.
We are very open and look to the council to help us form a strategy.
Okay. I have a couple of more questions, but I'd like to give my colleague an opportunity to ask the questions. Do you have amnesty questions or just on your bill?
Thank you for all the effort and transparency and just working together on this issue. This is a $1.6 billion problem that's been passed on to us from previous administrations, and our goal is to work with this administration, Department of Finance, and every single agency to make sure that when you write a ticket for a quality of life or protecting our people from things like toxic chemicals, that it's actually being written, that those items are actually being stopped, and that our people are being protected, and that justice is actually happening. So just to be clear, if you can go to page four, out of the 535,600 violations that are being issued, 50% of them, 53% of them are getting paid in full, which is good news. 9%, which is part of what we're trying to crack down on, are going to hopefully not be dismissed, because the point is we don't want to waste somebody's time by bringing them into ECB or elsewhere. So one piece is just hopefully as we're fixing these, we have fewer things being dismissed because of defective documents. But I guess one piece I'm troubled by is just 38% of the violations are ending up in collection, and then even with your 24%, we're looking at is a 29% of the people. So more than one in four people who get a NOV or a violation for doing something bad that we don't want them to do aren't facing the consequences for their actions. Is that accurate?
Your numbers are accurate. I think that, yes, it's an issue. There are many factors involved. As indicated, in some instances, we have people who sell their properties, mm-hmm. and then they are a lot harder to track down.
We'll get into it by just understanding it. So
at 30,000 feet,
yeah,
we have a large population of people who are not addressing those violations.
So out of those 535,600, 155,324 of those violations are not resolved. So I think that when people are thinking about it, and this is actually from an administration where we're actually trying to write fewer summonses and trying not to earn income off folks, these are, is it correct to characterize these as items that we're actually trying to correct behavior, which I think you mentioned in your testimony?
Yes.
And in terms of it, you've identified that of the problem, a lot of it is happening in two key agencies. So what we've seen looking through your report, and thank you for that report and supporting the passage of that legislation, which I co-sponsored with our chair, Ferraris Copeland, and we've seen it going through the data. It's been confirmed in the report. DOB issued summons in a way that is far disproportionate to the amount of summons that the agency is issuing when compared to other agencies. So they've issued $870 million of this outstanding debt, which is 55% of it. So out of all the 13 agencies, DOB seems to be the one place where that is. What about DOB issued summonses makes the debt so difficult to collect?
I guess one thing that I would cite would be the DOB summonses are more complex than other summonses. So when we look at the universe of summonses, we divide the universe into summonses that we call simple fines, which would be the Department of Sanitation summonses. So for failing to sweep the sidewalk or what have you, it's a one-time offense, or failing to separate recycling. It's a one-time offense. You're not required then to go back and sweep the sidewalk that day. You're required to pay the fine. When it comes to the Department of Buildings, you're required to fix whatever infraction Buildings has cited. And so that means that there's a little more difficult for someone to comply. They're not just supposed to pay. They're also, if there's a crack in the wall, if work's being done without a permit, whatever the infraction is that building observed, the homeowner is expected to fix that underlying condition.
And DOB is writing this fine, they're writing an order, they're writing a fine, they're saying please fix a dangerous condition or else, and then there is no or else for approximately 125,000.
The other reason why the DOB fines are very high in dollar amount is that the default penalties tend to be very high for the DOB violations. So the or else is fix it or contest it or be hit with a large fine for failing to have a hearing.
And so in terms of it, so DOB fine gets issued, should we be revoking that building owner's licenses or permits? Should we be revoking the builder or construction company or somebody who's doing that? What can we be doing? And this is all contemplated around Intro 810, where we're actually trying to create some or else.
Right. Well, that's something that we are very interested in having those conversations with you.
Does he want to come up?
Yeah, he's going to be so.
We are very interested in having those conversations with you. We think that DOB needs to be in the room, and as indicated, there needs to be a balance struck between the enhancing the tool to collect and being sensitive to their capacity to do those checks and enforce the rules.
So I've been advised by the Finance Committee Counsel Tanisha Edwards that we actually have DOB in the room.
Looks petrified.
I'd like to ask Patrick Whaley from Department of Buildings to come up. It's great to have him here. We've been hoping to sit down with him for several months now. And I will ask great. So I will ask our committee to please swear him in.
Do you affirm that your testimony will be truthful to the best of your knowledge, information, and belief?
I do.
Please proceed.
I'm here to do my best to answer any questions you might have. I didn't come with any prepared testimony.
So there's 125,108 summonses that have been issued by DOB that have been defaulted upon for a total of $874 million in outstanding debt. Of that, $225 million is penalties. Sorry, is base fines. $444 million is penalties. $204 million is interest. So if you could speak to us about who's getting these summonses? Is this homeowners, construction companies, builders? What is the difference between the base fine and the penalty? And why are we having so much trouble collecting these types of fines?
Okay, so in reverse order, the third question, while we're having so much difficulty, I think I'll defer to the Department of Finance on that. I really don't think I'm equipped to answer that type of question. But in terms of your first two questions, about 94% of the ECB issued debt in dollar value is issued to property owners. The remaining 6% is issued to folks who take out permits with the department.
And for the 6% who take out permits with the department, once they default, can they take out additional permits?
Depends on who they are. So a large number of folks who take out permits with the department, as you can imagine, happen to be holders of licenses. The department currently has the authority to not renew a license if that licensee has outstanding debt. And that's authority that we do exercise.
How many times have you not renewed a license or permit?
I don't have those exact numbers, but I'm happy to get them for you. I'd say that our success rate is pretty good. As you had mentioned earlier, if you reduce the total debt just to the base, not including the default, it's around like $216 million or something thereabouts. Our collection from license holders totals about, I think it's $1.8 million the last fiscal year.
I gotta believe that you're very efficient at what you do. We sent you an email with that particular question a month ago, so I'm hoping that you can get that to me as soon as possible from Tanisha Edwards. You can look it up, and if you can just get us that data, it would really help us.
I certainly will.
Okay, thank you.
I second my colleague's motion on that. And so I guess one concern here is 6% of the 225 should be around 12 million. So in terms of that, it shouldn't be a 1.8 million. It should be upwards of 12 million. So I'd love to figure out with you where that other 80% are. And then have you ever revoked or suspended a permit from somebody who has an outstanding fine, penalty, or interest?
Revoked a permit? I don't have that information with me, but I'm sure that's the case.
So I think you made news recently when you revoked one, but given that there's 125, Sega? So you permanently revoked a one for Brooklyn-based MRMD New York Corp. I guess very happy that that happened. It was covered by Sally Goldenberg at Capital New York. Would the DOB support 810, which would you support changes to 810 that would actually require that the permits be revoked when people don't pay off their debt?
Well, the instance you referenced was the registration for a general contractor that was revoked. Mm-hmm. There was a stipulation agreement with the law department to pay a very large volume of fines, which they neglected to pay, and that resulted in the revocation of their registration. I'd say on Intro 810, from a pure debt collection perspective, holding up permits certainly has some merit, but I think from the department's perspective, we think that there are other factors, perhaps unintended consequences, that the council may want to consider. The department does have concerns that denying permits based on outstanding debt has the potential to drive work underground, making the department's regulatory and enforcement efforts more challenging and having the potential to affect the safety of the public. And additionally, from our perspective, correcting an unsafe condition is more important than collecting a debt. And when the department takes enforcement action based on an unsafe condition, denying permits to correct that condition until debts are paid can result in the unsafe condition existing for a longer period of time or perhaps not being corrected at all. And I think the last thing I'd add, which I sort of mentioned earlier, was that, you know, of all the ECB-issued debt that the department has issued, a relatively small slice of this is issued to permit holders. The majority of it is issued, the overwhelming majority of it, is issued to owners of property who don't take out permits.
Thank you for reading your prepared remarks. It's good to know you brought them. So your position is that a general contractor that has done enough things, that you've issued enough debt, that we're now saying they didn't even bother paying it or correcting the conditions, that somehow that stops work for being done by somebody else to correct the underlying conditions? That there is no universe of other GCs that could be brought in to fix the underlying conditions or
No, not at all. What I'm saying is that that particular permit holder, if we're not going to be issuing new permits to that individual for the volume of outstanding debt, they may be inclined to do work underground and not seek permits in the future.
So if a person is doing things that are wrong and getting fined and then not paying the fines, your position is that it is better for them to continue to do that work and continue to disobey the laws and still be registered with you than to otherwise do exactly what they're doing without being registered with you.
What I'm saying is that in getting a permit, they would be subject to the regulation and enforcement of the buildings department. And
but
had they not sought that permit, it'd be far more difficult for us to be able to identify bad actors.
In both circumstances, the actor, the construction companies are doing whatever they want. It's just in one case you know about and you're not doing anything about it, and in another, you still find them because you see construction work has started and your inspectors walk by the site and they say, huh, there's no permit here, it's being done by a company without a registration, and they will face an entirely different set of penalties. So I guess I don't find favor with your argument and think that if we are trying to get people to follow the rules, we should. When you collected those $1.2 million from permit holders, did that get remitted to DOF or to DOB, or where did that money go, and is that reflected in DOF's report?
It's $1.8 million,
yes.
And it's from license holders, not from permittees, and I believe that money goes back to the general fund, if I'm not mistaken.
So in terms of the revenue we report...
Mike.
Sorry.
If... the ECB debt in question is in judgment, then that would be included in the revenue we report, the $50.1 million. If there's pre-judgment debt, then that would be attributed elsewhere in the budget, the $96 million that I referenced earlier in fiscal year 15.
And with regard to the, so with regard to the 6%, will DOB come back with a plan for Finance Committee and Governmental Operations, as well as perhaps the Buildings Committee, of just how you plan to make sure that every single permit holder and licensee is paying their fines when they get fined?
We can certainly work with the Department of Finance and get back to you on that.
Okay.
So I actually have a follow-up question. So I wanted to kind of delve deeper into that you say it's directly, as opposed to licensees and those permit holders, the fines and the majority are going to property owners, is that correct?
Yes.
Can you walk me through what does the average fine look like? I know that you have a plethora of things that you can find, but is it that, for example, is it illegal conversions? What does it look like?
So, as you had said, that the scope of types of violations that we can issue vary in those amounts, but generally initial violation could be anything in the order of $1,000 to $2,000 or $3,000. And that would be the ECB penalty that's assigned. Certain types of violations also have a corresponding Department of Building civil penalty, which being an additional penalty on top of that. And then, of course, if they default or if there are additional violations of the same sort on top of the one that was first issued, they would receive additional aggravated violations that are significantly higher.
And when you issue this these fines, do they say owner of, or do you find the person, or because we also have an issue with owner when you write owner of, right? So if you walk in and you have access, do you issue your fine to the property owner directly? Is that something that you do at DOB?
That's correct.
Okay. And for example, if there is someone who gets fined, who has a fine on their property, but they want to go and get a permit for some construction in their home or to do something new, what happens at DOB through that process?
Depending on the type of violation issued, they may be issued the permit to perform the work.
What is the difference in the type? What permit allows you to go ahead with no problem, and which one is stopped?
So the best way to explain are the ones where you wouldn't be allowed to get the permit. So certainly for a work without a permit violation, that you get an ECB violation, you get a corresponding DOB civil penalty as well. In that instance, in order to get the permit, you would need to pay the violation, because not to do so kind of makes a mockery of the idea of getting the work without a permit violation in the first place.
And is that the only example, or?
I think there's one other, which is working in violation of a stop work order. I think that's those are the two examples where that exists.
And why are those two, is there something that's prohibiting you from using other situations or other fines to, you know, kind of force people that when they want to engage with DOB, that they have to take care of all their other debt?
We certainly do our best with the Department of Finance to keep folks who have received violations, to try and do them, to compel them to pay. For the other types of violations where we don't require the payment, it goes back to the remarks that I made earlier, the concern the department has about driving that work underground and lengthening the period of time for them to correct violations that they've issued.
It just seems, you know, from our perspective, we want the debt to be collected. We go through this process, which in itself is very costly, right? How many people have to come today to testify to explain just the process of a ticket that may be $50, right? Or in your case, a little more, probably $1,000. And there are other opportunities where we are engaging with the same people that DOF is trying to find, but there's no coordination to say, hey, I have this person in front of me that wants to get a permit, but it seems like there's no coordination that says, oh, by the way, you owe us $2,000. And then you're saying, well, we'd rather them do it by getting a permit and not focus on the $2,000 that they owe. My understanding, tell me that I'm not understanding that correctly.
I think we wouldn't characterize it that way. Certainly for our licensees.
Sure you wouldn't characterize it that way.
Certainly for our licensees, when they apply for renewals, we don't just look at Department of Building issued ECB debt. We look at debt issued across all agencies before we renew their license.
I just think, and we have a lot of the players, and you're just one of the agencies. Obviously, there's a list of other agencies, FDNY, sanitation. It just seems to me that we can put in all the enforcement tools. We can give this to the sheriff, the marshals. We can give it to everybody. But if you guys aren't talking to each other, we're never going to get this debt paid, for sure. Like, that's guaranteed. And we're always going to be at 8%. So it just seems like, how do we not have a coordinated effort just to talk about this debt and for there to be agreements in between the agencies that say, DOF, we're going to help you collect. If this person that you're looking for the last 8 years, you send them letters, you've knocked on their doors, you've done everything, happens to come into DOB to ask for a permit because they want a new bathroom, we'll let you know. It just seems, I don't know, that seems pretty easy. But you guys make it so painfully hard. I don't understand. So that's going to be our next suggestion, and we're going to figure out a way to hopefully make that happen from our perspective, because it just seems that it's the only way that we're going to increase and improve the collection on this debt. And writing it off isn't the only answer that we have. So,
so just to follow up, and I agree with my co-chair and all of that. So 94% goes to property owners. What is the challenge to collecting against a property owner, right? Like, so it's, I live at 1520 York. I let's say I'm the owner there. So you know where I live, you know where the property is. How do I get away with not paying?
Well, one of the challenges is that the summons and the judgment is not issued against the property. So one thing that when I talked last year, I addressed and want to make sure that we're clear about is that this debt is harder to collect than, for example, parking violations. If parking violations go unpaid, then somebody who is incurring the violations is driving around an asset, namely the vehicle, that can be seized to help pay for the violation. The violations that turn into judgments for Department of Building and other ECB adjudicated violations are against an individual. We have to go against the individual. We're not authorized to go against the individual's property to collect. And so that means we need to not only know where they live, and certainly we are sending bills to that address, but if they refuse to pay, we have to identify an asset that they have that we can go after.
Does the law provide for you to convert your judgment into a lien against a person's property?
No, generally speaking, no. There is a small exception where some Department of Building violations pertaining to illegal conversion of 1, 2, and 3 family properties can be converted to liens if at the very beginning of the process the lien holders and mortgage holders receive the notice of violation and have an opportunity to adjudicate the violations themselves.
Would an expansion of introduction 807 for owner, wouldn't the introduction 807 owner of allow you to collect against the person, and would it be helpful if it was expanded to from in personam jurisdiction to in rem jurisdiction, so that if the law is stopping you from collecting, good news, we get to write laws. So would 807 be helpful in terms of allowing, providing you the power to not only bring liens, which I think is another introduction we have that isn't being heard today, but as well as convert the judgments into having in rem jurisdiction?
In general, expansion of that authority to bring more in rem would be something that finance would be interested in, and I think buildings shares that. And in fact, we have just started for the small slice of violations for which that conversion is authorized by law. We have just commenced making sure that the lien holders and mortgage holders are notified at the point of the notice of violation so that they may be converted. We've been working with buildings and with Oath ECB to have that done. It's just started, so it's too preliminary to report results, but we would be interested in seeing an expansion of that authority, yes.
Okay, and then with regard to 810, can DOB provide a list of the licenses and permits that you believe could be revoked automatically when somebody is in default on a judgment that has been rendered by Oath that would not frustrate the purposes that you're concerned about? Having an enumerated list like that would be helpful.
Understood, we'll provide that.
Thank you, but you believe there is a universe of permits and licenses that could either not be issued or revoked to actually get people to incentivize that behavior without forcing people underground?
I think that's probably right. It might be very difficult to sort of draw that line, but I understand.
And how many, just in terms of, just to quantify the problem, how many construction companies do you believe are doing work without a permit? And how many of those violations are you writing a year?
I don't have that information with me. Certainly I can provide you with the data in terms of violations that we've issued to construction companies.
Do you have more questions for DOB? Because I have questions about DSNY, which is the second one. Okay, so Patrick, I think you are, thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us and stepping up. And we look forward to working with you as part of this. And actually, for both of you, and we'll ask the next panel this, would you be willing to take part in an interagency task force with the 13 agencies that are writing ECB violations, DOF, Oath, and the Finance Committee, GovOps, to really get to the bottom of this, get everyone to the table, and make sure that these bills are as strong as possible?
So for myself, thanks for having me, and I'll certainly take that back and report back to the committees on what we can do, okay?
Yes, we would be interested in participating. We have been meeting within the administration with Oath and the major issuing agencies. So we're happy to meet with you on that as well.
Thank you. So now I'm on, that was question number one. Number two, the agency with the largest number of summonses is Department of Sanitation. They weigh in at 1.1 34 million summonses for a total of $382 million dollars, and that accounts for 24% of the ECB debt. So between the two agencies, that's 79% mm-hmm. of all the debt, which with the 80-20 rule is one way we could deal with that. Why is this so?
Why
do you believe that Department of Sanitation is coming in with so many summonses and so many of them getting to you and not getting resolved?
I think that question really needs to be direct in terms of the number of summonses. That's something that sanitation would need to address. In terms of what comes to us, we did have the slide where we had the collection rates of the various agencies. So I think sanitation was 'So I don't have information with me today on why the sanitation rate is lower than for the other agencies. I think that is the next step for us. We've taken sort of the first step to start to segment the debt, and now that we see the success rates of the agencies, the next step is identifying factors that would make their summonses less collectible than others.
Thank you. I will pass it back to our co-chair.
Thank you. We are going to have the next panel come up. Thank you for coming to testify. Several questions that we're going to get to you. So if you can get them back to us, I would really appreciate it so we can make recommendations also as we go along. And I just wanted to acknowledge that last year you did suggest openly that there should be an interagency conversation on this debt. Mm-hmm. So that came from your recommendations and your suggestions. So we're just going to follow up to make sure that that happens. Okay?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Let's call up our next panel. We have Commissioner Fidel Del Valle of Oath.
They can make it warmer in here. They have to call DCAS.
Yeah, good luck with that.
If the sergeant at arms could call DCAS and raise the temperature in this room.
I hear the one next door is boiling, so maybe we could get some heat from next door. Of course, this is all going to be transcribed now in the hearing.
It's really nice to hear my name pronounced right.
There, isn't it great?
The double L freaks out a lot of people.
Yeah. Do you affirm that your testimony will be truthful to the best of your knowledge, information, and belief?
I do.
Excellent. You may begin your testimony.
My name is Fidel Del Valle. I am the Commissioner of the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings and the Chief Administrative Law Judge of the City of New York. I'm also the Chairman of the Environmental Control Board. The Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings, OATH, is one of the largest independent administrative law courts in the United States. OATH's Hearings Division adjudicates a wide variety of summonses. In calendar year 2014, this division held over 300,000 live hearings that resulted from about 700,000 summonses that were issued. OATH's Trials Division was previously referred to as the Oath Tribunal and adjudicates the more complex administrative law matters that include city contract cases, human rights violations, employee disciplinary cases, and law board cases. As an independent administrative court, Oath's primary mission is to provide impartial, fair, and timely trials and hearings to everyone who appears before the administrative law judges and hearing officers of Oath. Oath keeps both the public and the enforcement agencies informed of its commitment. Oath regularly provides to issuing agencies statistical data concerning disposition of summonses returnable to Oath, Hearings Division, including dismissal rates. To inform the public, Oath posts quarterly reports containing this data on its website. And pursuant to Local Law Number 64, Oath now provides the council, public advocate, and enforcement agencies with a monthly dismissal report concerning for-hire vehicles and taxi hearings, health and restaurant hearings, and ECB hearings. Oath's dismissal report provides the number and reasons for dismissals. The reasons for these dismissals might include, but are not limited to, improper service, defective summonses, and dismissal on the merits. Now, specifically in reference to Intro 811, Oath is committed to its mission to act as an impartial forum where equity and fairness are the goals. The proposed legislation requiring agencies to amend summonses if they are aware of deficiencies therein will make the process more difficult than it currently exists. Currently, enforcement agencies contact Oath. Oath corrects errors prior to a hearing date, subject to due process requirements. The summons may also be amended on motion at the hearing if there is no negative impact on the respondent's due process rights. For instance, where a summons reverses the first and last names of the respondent, but the respondent appeared at the hearing. In more simple terms, right now, if an agency finds that there was an error in the summons that it issued, it can go online into our system within 72 hours, make that correction themselves, and provide proof that the respondent was notified of the correction. After that period of time, they will have to contact Oath with a correction together with proof that the respondent was notified. Finally, if at the hearing itself it is found that there was an error on the summons that is not a substantive error, a perfect example is this, and it happens very commonly, especially handwritten summonses. A lot of summonses are still handwritten. The enforcement agent may incorrectly put down the section of rule or law violation that the person is charged with violating. But the narrative itself articulates the actual violation in detail, and the respondent understands what the actual violation was. And they both defend it on the respondent defends it on the merits, and the agency prosecutes it on whatever merits they have. If there's a motion made to make a correction at that point, and it is not a substantial change, that is to say, the respondent is clearly on notice of what he is being charged with, then the amendment will be allowed. If, however, the requested amendment is to something that is significantly different, for example, where the elements of the offense are different than what was stated on the summons, then that amendment will not be allowed, and probably the summons will be dismissed, and the agency will have to start by reissuing a new summons in the process with proper notice to the respondent. The problem, if you can call it a problem, or the concern with this particular piece of legislation is that it puts time limits on the process. The process right now, pursuant to our rules, basically has no time limits. And corrections can be made at any point so long as the due process rights of the respondent are not compromised in any way. In reference to Intro 812, which I call the Block and Lot Bill, the Identifier Bill, the legislation requiring enforcement agencies to include unique identifiers, including block and lot or property registration number, does not really have an impact on Oath operationally. However, And this is an aside, which I think should be brought to the council's attention. There exist property lots that include multiple properties within the lots, making it exceedingly difficult, if not impossible, to identify the property block and lot. This is what I mean. There are some co-ops, for example, in Queens, where you have a block and lot, and inside the block and lot, you may have as many as 200 different houses. With that understanding, in those cases, this legislation, we think, is a good idea. Right now, the buildings department summonses that we are receiving include block and lot information, which we include in our database. There seems to be an urban legend going around that I've heard already three times in the last 2 weeks that Olt's computer system doesn't capture block and lot numbers. It does. We have been doing it, but we only do it in those cases where the issuing agency actually puts down the block and lot on the summons. I want to echo something that Jeff Shear testified to a while ago, and it's this, and this is very important in the context of Oath, that the only legitimate purpose for fines and other penalties is to induce compliance with laws and regulations designed to maintain public safety and order. The purpose is never policing for profit. The fundamental issue of this legislation is addressing is that when fines and penalties can be ignored with impunity, all public safety and order laws and regulations are essentially pointless and worthless, which I think was an issue that was brought up earlier. From my perspective, where I sit in adjudications, it is very frustrating to adjudicate a matter that results in a penalty that turns out to be a meaningless exercise if it can be ignored with impunity. And I'll accept any questions that you may have on any of the bills before you today.
Thank you, Commissioner Del Valle. Thank you for coming to testify. So I'm going to have a broader conversation, and then I have another, a more specific one. But DOS report that was released this month, $709 million, roughly half, is from default penalties levied because the respondents failed to appear at a hearing. What can the city be doing better to ensure an individual shows up at a hearing?
About a year ago, when I arrived in this position, I saw those same numbers and I found them very troublesome. So we started looking into that. And there are many reasons for it, but some of the reasons are bureaucratic obstructions. For example, and I think, I don't know if the OF is still here, but I think they'll agree with me with this. Somebody gets a summons. Say a sanitation summons. I'm just picking that out as an example. And they get the summons and they want to either contest the summons or just pay the summons. And they go over to the ECB tribunal to, I want to pay the summons. And we would tell them, certainly a year or two ago, we can't do that because we don't know about the summons' existence. So we don't know what to adjudicate, we don't know what the penalty is, et cetera. Because the system that existed at the time involved a sanitation inspector issuing the summons, which is a paper summons. It stayed in his car for maybe a day or two, then it went to the box, and then it was sent to ECB. ECB then sends it to a vendor to scan it and put it into data entry. To make a long, ridiculous, serpentine story, it could take 3 weeks before we knew about it. That's an example. When I conferred with the mayor's office on this. It was decided that, among other things, this is one issue that has to be cleaned up. And the process has started. Perfect example of that now is sanitation is starting to convert to electronic summons writing. We get, for those units that at sanitation, which is not all of sanitation yet, they do an electronic summons writing, we have the summons within 24 hours. The beauty of that part is, though, that as far as the respondent is concerned, and this is almost a psychological thing, if you can take care of the summons right away, most people take care of it right away. If I tell you to come back in a month, they'll forget about it.
Right.
It's just human nature.
Right.
What we have seen with sanitation, that's starting to convert, Department of Transportation, which is almost completely converted, there is a dramatic drop in bad summonses that are being written because a lot of it is electronic. It's not a matter of how good the inspector's handwriting is. He picks the right section of the violation, pushes the button, and that's what prints out. You don't have to worry about whether they put a decimal point here or there or not. And the respondent gets a clear document. For example, again, sanitation summons is what they're doing electronically. They will leave a paper copy of the summons at the residence or building or wherever it was that it applied to. They go back, they check out, and eventually they'll be able to do this in the field if everything goes according to plan. And they will generate another copy of the summons with the actual owner's name on it as it appears in the city registry and mail it.
Okay.
So that covers, that enhances the two process mechanism and the rest. The other part of it is making it easier for human beings to deal with summonses, period, apart from us timely having the summons. To that end, we have instituted a system whereby in all our hearing rooms, the hearing officer has access on his desk, a direct line to a translation service that provides translation in 84 languages. And I've heard this thing in action, and it is awesome. I've done a lot of depositions with translators, and the way the system operates online is absolutely amazing. We are also enhancing the process of people being able to adjudicate summonses remotely using either submitting your defenses or your payment for that matter online, or having a live hearing online either by telephone or eventually, as we've already started experiments with the Port Authority Police, which writes some of our summonses, where the officer who wrote the summons is on a television monitor and the respondent may be on a television monitor and the hearing officer is on another one, and we conduct the hearing that way and nobody has to leave wherever they're doing. The enforcement personnel don't have to travel to some other point in their back doing their enforcement thing. You're in your office or even in your home, you can do your thing to deal with the summons. And our hearing officer is at our facility, which actually makes the facility less stressful. Those are just a few of the examples of the things that we're doing along those lines.
And I guess this, you can wrap it, okay. You can add it to your wrap up, okay. But when people, or I guess those that are fined come in, what's the hardship that you hear that's expressed Is it that the summons is incorrect? Is it that they can't pay? Like, is there a hardship that's expressed? And as the judge, can you, or the person who has the authority over the summons, what are the hardships that you consider when going through this hearing process?
On a specific summons or going through the process?
Both, actually.
As far as going through the process, the biggest complaint I hear is how long it takes when you get there. Example, there was a particular agency, I won't name it right now in order to protect the guilty, but they they would write all their summonses returnable at 8:30 in the morning.
Oh, all fines?
Yeah. At 8:30 in the morning, which is not necessarily a bad thing, because we can provide enough hearing officers to do it, but if they only send for 140 summonses for people to testify, it backs everybody up, because you can only do four at a time rather than 20 at a time. And the ugly part is, I'm John Q. Citizen or whatever, I got this summons and I'm being a good citizen, I'm coming here at 8:30 in the morning to have my summons heard. It's now 2:00 in the afternoon, and I see a hearing officer sitting there with nothing in front of him, and frankly, we look like incompetent idiots. And they're not interested in hearing that the reason that they're backed up is that they can only do four hearings at a time because everything was scheduled at 8:30 in the morning, and there's only four guys that they sent to present their summonses. We're resolving that pretty much right now by inducing that agency to, number one, stagger the summonses, and number two, if within a certain period of time, and I'm talking about a half hour, if they're not prepared to go forward with the summons, and the respondent is prepared to go with the summons, then we will proceed with the case whether or not the agency is ready to go or not. And if the summons stands on its own, it'll go forward. If the summons cannot stand on its own, it'll be dismissed. And the agency, and some agencies have decided to do this anyway, regardless of this process. If they decide not to send anybody to represent the agency at the hearing, that their summons is a sworn to summons that stands by itself, then they'll run the risk, and it's a calculated risk on their part, whether or not the respondent can easily rebut the summons or not. And if the respondent rebuts it, it's dismissed.
Okay. I'm gonna have some follow-up questions, but I'm gonna allow my co-chair to ask his questions.
Thank you very much for your remarks on why we write these summonses and the purpose of justice and having impartiality and just trying to protect the people of our city. So thank you for those. And thank you for your service and all the great news about the things that you're working on. So I guess one important question. So in terms of a challenge that might exist with making sure we have block and lot, will the issuing of using electronic tools to issue summonses overcome that and make sure that we're getting the right block and lot, and do those things actually work together?
In fact, there is a project that has just recently been undertaken by us with the 16 agencies that write the bulk of the summonses that we adjudicate, to streamline the process. And and the process that I'm talking about directly on oath is communicating the summons data to oath and back to the feedback back to the enforcement agencies. A collateral effect of that has been the system is being designed so that eventually every enforcement agent in the city will be able to issue summonses electronically that are GPS enabled and have a link not only to Oath's database, but will have a link to Department of Finance's block and lot database and Department of Buildings building identification number database, so that an inspector, for example, building inspector, sanitation inspector, whatever, standing in front of a building, the machine he's holding in his hands will immediately tell him what the block and lot number is and who the owner of the property is, and everything can be generated right there.
Do you anticipate that in combination of the program you've already undertaken plus the block and lot bill will minimize the number of cases dismissed for wrong party cited, which is numerous in your report?
I expect that not only would it do that, I think it would also reduce the number of specious appeals where people claim that they never had notice of a summons.
With regard to introduction 8.12, so what you'd recommend is where it's clear that there's an individual property associated with the borrowed block and lot number, that be sufficient, but in a location such as a cooperative or condo, that we supplement the unique identifier of the block and lot with the actual address as well.
I think the actual address should always appear on it. If, for example, for mailing purposes, mm-hmm. We have to notify, for example, if somebody defaults, we have to send them a copy of the default. It's handy to have their address. I mean, we can look it up from the block and lot, but if it's already there, it's a lot more simple.
And with regard to 8.11, thank you for bringing up the actual practice, as is the as our by your regulation. So if we were to remove the timelines from introduction 8.11, which would in essence just place into the law what your practice already is, would that be acceptable to oath?
Absolutely.
Thank you. And if I may ask you to go a little bit out of portfolio with regard to introduction 807, if you can talk about whether or not it is appropriate to have owner of apply to allow it to be in rem, which would be applying it to property.
Right now, if we, just broadly speaking, right now if we receive a summons to adjudicate that says owner of a particular piece of property, we will proceed with the hearing. If it's an individual from the agency that issued the summons is there, it'll be prosecuted. If the respondent is there, is prosecuted. And if there is a default, essentially, nobody shows up, a default judgment will be issued. Essentially, an owner of, quote unquote, is treated as a John Doe in a complaint, in a civil complaint. And having from a prior incarnation in practice of law, John Doe works to pursue a civil action anywhere, so long as at a certain point you find out who that John Doe was when you get to a judgment. To make a long story short, the adjudication is still valid if we just get a owner of summons.
So, and by, so in terms of moving forward as if they are John Doe and the civil piece, would there be any change for oath if it was that you're collecting against owner of plus the property itself, and that way you're able to have in personam as well as in rem jurisdiction?
I don't think it would have any impact one way or the other on oath. It's a matter of policy more of the enforcement agencies than of oath. For example, DEP insists on withdrawing a summons and starting over in cases where there's an issue of owner of, but that's just, at the end of the exercise, doesn't change anything.
Has the volume of owner of summonses remained the same?
Excuse me?
Has the volume of owner of summonses mm-hmm. issued to owner of remained the same, or have they gone down? And what steps is Oath and the issuing agencies taking to address the problems before a hearing? Which I think you've already gone to the latter piece, but is the volume of owner of going down?
The volume of owner of is going down as more and more agencies are going to electronic summons writing. And as they go down, not only is the owner of part going down, but errors in the writing of the summonses is going down. And I don't have the actual numbers, but in some cases by as much as 50% has drop in error with the electronic system and in having the actual name of the owner of the property on the summons.
And thank you for your jurisprudence on 807. With regard to, according to your report, there were 200 ECB dismissals because of defective service. Is that when the person shows up and says, I never got it? Or what is, I know what defective service is in the civil service, civil rules of procedure. What does it mean for Oath?
Believe it's section 1049A of the charter specifies the service process in many of these cases, and essentially it calls for, as we called it in law school, nail and mail service. And if it can't be established that copy of the summons was left on the property and one was timely mailed to the respondent, that's defective service. Those are the most mechanical ones. There are technical ones, such as very often happens. I get complaints at least two or three times a week about these. They issued the service to, they served the neighbor property for a violation on some other person's property. That's defective service. And that typically is exposed when the respondent shows up and has proof that this isn't my property, that sort of thing.
With regard to introduction 810, do you believe that if we removed the timeline requirement and fine requirement and change it from agencies could but shall revoke permits and licenses, and this again would follow making sure that it's actually permits and licenses that would be helpful instead of harmful to the public good, that would increase the number of people who pay up to Oath versus going into default?
I'm stepping a little bit out of character here for a second, but short answer is yes. Short answer is yes. And again, this is more of a policy issue for individual enforcement agencies. But I'm speaking now as having been in charge of an enforcement agency before coming to Oath.
Which one is that?
Taxi and Limousine Commission. And the system that exists there, which, by the way, we adjudicate their cases. And that gives me an additional perspective. TLC has, I think, close to 200,000 licensees. Drivers, owners, fleet operators, brokers, meter shop operators, and so forth. including paratransit. The process at oath hearings for their summonses is very straightforward. If you're innocent, that is found not guilty of the charged offense, that's the end of the case. If you're found guilty of the offense and a penalty is imposed, generally speaking, you have 30 days to pay the fine. 30 days after that, your license is suspended until you pay the fine. There's very, very little problem collecting TLC fines when the respondent knows if they don't pay the fine within 30 days, they're out of business. There's another variation on that, which is if it's a safety-related issue that goes with the fine, then they're also required to, depending on what the safety issue is and how serious the safety issue is, if they're found guilty, they are suspended. They're suspended at the moment of the hearing until they correct the condition. If it's less of a critical issue, they have 10 days or 30 days to correct the condition. Otherwise, their license is automatically suspended until compliance. Now, what I'm suggesting is, and this is a public policy issue, either for the council or for individual enforcement agencies, as to whether they want to adopt something similar. But speaking from my experience, it is remarkable how quickly somebody complies when they're about to be put out of business. And that also applies to DEP orders. Somebody can get a DEP summons for not having a backflow preventer on their sanitation system. And they'll come in, have a hearing, they get a fine, and they do not fix the violation. They'll eventually get an order from the commissioner to fix it, and they'll ignore it. Then they come and ask for another hearing where a cease and desist order is issued, and they'll ignore that. And finally, 2 years later, they'll come in and ask for a sealing order. And amazingly, as DEP goes out there to seal the equipment, they manage to figure out how to comply. So that's just my perspective, but I think it's important. Because I can tell you right now, it's very frustrating to sit in an adjudicatory function and issue findings or judgments that are ignored, and you feel like it's a pointless exercise.
Thank you for going over some of the places that things are very broken and with suggestions on how to fix it. I asked Department of Finance and I asked DOB, would you be willing to participate in an interagency group with Committee Chair on Finance as well as Committee Chair on Governmental Operations to work with the 13 issuing agencies to get to the bottom of what's going on and get all those fines issued, paid, and get those behaviors corrected?
Absolutely, I have no problem whatsoever. We've already, Finance Commissioner and I, back in February, got together and we created a working group between us on finding ways to make the system work better, as is between our respective agencies communicating data and information that is necessary for them and helpful for us in our process. And we've gone a fairly long way on it. And as recently as a week ago at the direction of the mayor, we met at the commissioner level with about 16 different city agencies and formed a working group to ultimately have the goal of uniform summonses across uniform summons structure, uniform procedural structure, and the uniform IT structure throughout the city, with a target of the end of next year. The IT part of it is going to be the biggest hurdle that we found. We found that we are dealing with 14 different computer systems plus quill pens in a few agencies, and the systems don't all talk to each other. I found that Oath has 4 different computer systems. The agencies that feed information to us have 10 different systems. Some of them are very sophisticated and very modern. Some of them we found out go back to 1984, which I think is like a Commodore 64 type thing that we had as kids. The city has committed to putting in significant resources into making the system work.
And just to be clear, so when something's adjudicated by Oath, the person can, and if they're found guilty, they can then pay at Oath?
Right now, yes.
And then they have 45 days or however long after the order to correct or pay at Oath, and then it goes to DOF. And I guess, how many people where you adjudicate and find that the person owes pay Oath, and how many of the cases that you adjudicate against the respondent end up at DOF? Catch you by surprise on that one.
I believe it's like 58% pay.
Okay.
Right away. There they go to collection another percentage within a relatively small period of time, pays, and then it's finances nightmare.
So I guess my question specifically pertains to, so of the 53% according to DOF, those are the folks who are adjudicated and pay. I'm curious if you can break out the people who default and do not pay, in which case they may have never shown up, and the people who lose the case. We've seen them, we've met them in person, there's a human being, they have a pulse, we know what they look like, and then they just decide not to pay. So I would be curious to see who those people are and see what their payment is, what rate is, once it goes to collections and items like that, because I feel like there's a difference between a person we've never managed to contact or disappeared and we never found them versus a person who did show up lost and we that lost. I'm curious how many of those people we are losing.
I was just looking through my notes to see if I had that number. I don't, but you're right, because that type of individual clearly is thumbing their nose at the system.
So I would be interested in it. Would you be willing to share that information with us?
Absolutely.
Thank you very much. That ends my questioning.
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you, Commissioner Del Valle, for coming to our hearing today. We do have additional questions that we're going to get to you, so if you can have them, get them to our committee as soon as possible, I would greatly appreciate it. And we're going to be following up on the interagency conversation or task force, whatever we're going to title it, as soon as possible. Okay?
Sure.
Thank you, Commissioner. And now we will have our final panel. Robert Bookman of the New York City Hospitality Alliance, come testify.
While we are waiting for our next panel, I just want to thank our finance chair, our staff, and the administration, because we are able to have a working group or task force or whatever we want to call it without passing a bill to do so, which
that's
is
great.
Yes.
That's
I'm an entire panel. Wow. Thank you, all your other council members. I'll be a little less formal, if you don't mind, since it's assessment. My name is Rob Bookman. I have testified before council many times over the last 30 years, over many councils. My last job in city government was at the Department of Consumer Affairs. I was director of adjudication, which is, I guess, a good topic today. I thought the oath testimony, by the way, was great, very elucidating. In my practice in the last 30 years, I represent small businesses. That's what I do, and two particular trade associations, the New York City Hospitality Alliance, which is about 2,000 restaurants, bars, nightclubs, hotels in the city of New York, and my much smaller organization, and my older one, is the New York City Newsstand Operators Association, the 300 sidewalk, mostly immigrant newsstand operators, so really small mom-and-pop stuff. So I'm really here in all that, you know, capacity, and I worked with prior administrations with the bills that brought a lot of the work to oath, and we did a lot of reforming legislation years ago that reformed oath, and I think they've been doing a much, much better job than ECB used to do when they were alone. Having said that, and I thought that you guys really elicited a tremendous number of facts and tremendous amount of information, I'm representing small businesses, and seeing this data, I realize it's a small percentage of the overall, because, you know, buildings is the bulk of it, and the people I'm dealing with, for the most part, are not the people who are getting those building violations. But I'm worried about the potential impact on some of these bills, you know, on the small business community. And my initial reaction was I was kind of surprised, you know, in reading it, because this council and this mayor has been particularly known for let's get government off the backs of small businesses, which for too long were viewed as ATM machines, you know, especially by the prior administration. And you folks and the prior council passed lots of legislation that we were integrally involved with in trying to reform that process. And what I always said was, you know, we could pass all the laws we want trying to reform it, but the best reform is having somebody at the top with a different attitude. And that's really what we've had in the last 2 years, and it's been a breath of fresh air. And we see it in our practice, we see it anecdotally, that the number of gotcha violations, and nuisance violations are down dramatically. So that's all great, but what concerns me here is we're talking a lot about how do we make it easier for the city to collect on violations, many of which will be against small businesses. Since they're going back 8 years, a lot of the unpaid dollars, if you will, are the very same gotcha and nuisance violations that we were all complaining about. And now we're talking about passing legislation, making it easier to put people out of business and revoke their licenses or not let new people go into business because they haven't paid some old gotcha violation that may not have been even served upon them properly before Oath took over ECB. So I think we need to look at these things prospectively versus retroactively, and I'm concerned about applying any of these things retroactively to the current outstanding dollars as opposed to going forward after all these reforms have been put in. The next point I want to make is that, you know, just sitting here, it seems to me that I'm an active New Yorker. I don't think we have a collection problem. I think we have a default problem. I mean, and Councilman Kellis, you asked a number of excellent questions concerning just that issue. The percentage of these outstanding monies that come from defaults is staggering. And I think we really need to work together, and I know our community, business community, the chambers of commerce that I spoke to, the partnership would be very happy being part of any group that you put together to talk about that real issue, because a lot of this outstanding money is because people didn't know about the fines in the first place. They didn't know about the summons in the first place. And to say that we now, a pizza place that went out of business 3 years ago in your neighborhood, and that owner now is coming to open up a new pizza place at a different location 3 years later, be told that he may not be able to get the sidewalk cafe or the health department license to open that business because there's some outstanding summons from years ago. without a process for giving an opportunity to reopen that summons to prove that it was served properly, I think is fundamentally unfair. And you folks are going to get inundated with complaints from the small businesses, the restaurants, in your neighborhoods, who are now going to be told that they may lose their license. There's a difference between not paying a fine for a violation that your licensing agency gave you and was adjudicated, versus I can't get a license renewed because I have a restaurant and sanitation allegedly gave me a ticket 3 years ago.
So I'm sorry, we're gonna be a little bit more informal, right? And I think it's important that we communicate accurately, right? This has been years in the making, and we've been talking about what the challenges has been with DOF in collecting their fines. What we are hearing today is recommendations on how to make sure that, one, fines are given accurately, that the agencies do the proper work to figure out who the owners are, as opposed to just giving it to like random, hopefully to address the default process. And I also, we can't overlook the fact that we are actually proposing an amnesty program. While I understand and we are very, very supportive, I was this morning with a group of my small businesses, right? We understand the fabric, and many of your clients, we represent as constituents. This is really for a lot of the bad actors that have gone for years without paying their fines. I'd like to think we obviously have proven today in this hearing that there is no coordinated effort, that if you go get a license in one place because you have a fine in DOF, is going to trigger that you don't get this license. That is not where we are. We are going to engage in further conversations with all the agencies. That is not the intention. However, the intention here, especially for me as finance chair, when we have to figure out what programs we're going to move forward, and there's $1.5 billion in debt that's uncollected, that we collect that, which has been gone through due process, has gone through the process of noticing, the process of all of it, that we should be able to collect on that. But as was stated, we're collecting on 8.8%, so most of the money is not being collected. I would love to work with your organization to figure out ways that we can continue to be supportive of small businesses. But the focus today is really an amnesty program to get people out of the shadows and to be able to pay the debt that sometimes they actually do go to ECB and show face and decide, you know what, I'm not going to pay that fine. I'm not saying that those are your customers, because it very well probably, if they belong to an association, it's usually not the people we're talking about. And as the Department of Building stated, it's very different. But there is a plethora of those of individual cases that really have very minimal fines that have grown astronomically. And we're saying, take away the penalties, take away everything that you've added on, and a $50 fine can become a $40 fine or a $35 fine, and you can pay it. And that is what this hearing is about today. And I'm sure my colleague will have something else to add, but it's about kind of engaging and hearing your voice. And I'm very excited that you're here to testify. With this huge room of participants.
It's a complicated set of bills, no question about it, and no question that the city is entitled to collect on legitimate fines where there were adjudicated violations, where both sides were there. But what I'm hearing today is the bulk of the uncollected fines are where both sides were not there, where there was a default. And that default, and your amnesty program doesn't address the ability to people to open up those defaults, only to pay as if they were guilty, as if they showed up. That's not fair.
If I can speak to it, we did not have the numbers on the defaults, and that is something that we asked questions on, we'll be following up on. Just some key issues. 55% of what we're talking about is DOB.
Right.
So it's issued by DOB, so it is not going to be in the hospitality industry, it's going to be in the construction industry. The next big group is sanitation, which might affect some of your members. But again, here, we're dealing with, I imagine, as my co-chair shared, the people who are in your association are not the people who are leaving trash out and when they're not supposed to be and leaving things littering on the street. So I have a problem in my district where one store puts its trash out in front of all the other stores. And I can't do anything to stop them other than write fines to them, but then they don't have to pay. And as we saw today, one in four people don't bother paying, people or corporations don't even bother paying their fines. So I think what we're trying to do here is make sure that people don't end up in a situation where they get so many fines that they go out of business, but in fact, people know when they get the fine, they show up, that they're the right person to show up. So the unique identifier means that you're not getting a fine for your next door neighbor, you're getting a fine for you. And then that's moving forward, and then where it's owner of, we're actually able to track and get it to the right person instead of the wrong person, because at the end of the day, we want people to be able to eat healthy, not have to worry about bad things happening with their food, and be able to make sure that the environment is protected. But all of this is just to make sure that when we write something, that it's actually enforced and corrects the behavior instead of just having, at this point, the $386 million in interest isn't the issue here. The issue is that we want to actually write these summonses, get them resolved before it becomes a half a billion dollar problem.
Oh, I agree. No, there's no question about that. I agree. Historically, my recollection, sanitation always had a very large uncollectible because they also had one of the largest defaults because of the way they served violations. And I don't know if that's ever been cured. Your situation is obviously there needs to be other there needs to be other mechanisms to stop somebody who is being served properly and is just ignoring the city and not correcting the underlying violation. But all too often, we and I'm sure you're not going to want a business not to be able to open because of a sanitation ticket that was defaulted 3 years ago because it was put on the door and no one ever showed up. ECB says they can only dismiss those when somebody shows up and points out that it was defective service. If nobody shows up to point out that it was defective service because they didn't get it, well, that's one of those uncollected defaults. And so I don't think the city's really owed that amount of money when you knock out all the defaults that were based on defective service.
And I think part of the reason we tried to hear this as a package is because we actually have good cop with the sweet amnesty at the same time as bad cop with let's actually have some teeth.
So anyway, we you know, we're here, we're interested. I know I spoke to the Manhattan Chamber of Commerce. You know, they're interested. Nancy was away. We'd like to be part of the process. We appreciate that the council notified us, you know, of these bills. That's always helpful, and we appreciate that. We want to make sure that your legitimate concerns, both the non-compliant people and the collection issues, are not resolved in such a way that we have this unintended consequence of legitimate businesses that never knew of violations in the first place now rushing to your office saying, you know, they want to put me out of business because 3 years ago I had a corporation that went out of business and now I want to open up a new corporation, they won't let me.
Right. I don't think any, you know.
And I know that's not your intention.
Right. It is not our intention. And I don't think, unfortunately, what we learned today is that they don't work that fast. So what we do need from you is to help us spread the word, you know, once we get this amnesty approved to your clients or your members so that they can take advantage for those that are in this area that they haven't been able to pay, that they can take advantage of the amnesty program.
I think the last time you pointed out the amnesty didn't work all that well was because there was no way, and I think we're repeating that mistake, there was no way of requesting a default to be reopened and then it was just you had to accept the fact that there was a default. And I think you should be able to request a default be reopened because of sewer service or lack of service. And I think you'll get more people involved in the process, you know, if that's an option in your program.
Duly noted. Thank you very much
for coming
to testify. I'm calling this hearing adjourned.